Thanks very much, Kim. So as Paul said, my name is Cliff Mo. I'm the newest member of the myeloma team here at Dana-Farber. And let me just start off by saying that, and I hope I don't make Kim angry, but I've been here in Boston for about 9 months, and I can say without a doubt that the pizza up here is absolutely worth any subsequent GI disturbance that happens afterwards. So between Boston and New Haven, Frank Pepe's, I think it's best pizza in the world. But in any case, so as Paul said, you know, I'm the newest member of the team. Previous to this, I was a hematologic oncologist, multiple myeloma and transplant specialist at Walter Reed for 6 years before coming here. And I know we're towards the end of the day and you must be exhausted by now, but I actually do have the luxury of not having another family obligation until dinner time. So unlike Paul, I don't have to leave you. And in fact, we can, I'm not sure when the lights are shutting off, but you can pretty much leave me after all your questions have been answered, and happy to answer any questions about any topic that was you know, covered today, or even those that were not covered today. If you have a question, just please come to the microphone. Yeah.
I have a question regarding bone pain. I know Kim mentioned it a little bit, but for myeloma, if you're undergoing treatment, no tumors or anything, I know a lot of people that still say they have different bone pain. Is that part of just getting old, or is that something to do with myeloma in itself?
No, that's a great question. I think the answer is oftentimes different for each individual. Certainly, you know, even for people who don't have, you know, overtly large visible lesions, there can sometimes be, you know, subradiographic, you know, damage being done to the bones, which can cause pain that's not visible on plain X-ray, or, you know, if you happen to do a PET CT scan or MRI, you could catch an early lesion at the site of the pain. So that's one possibility. And then the other possibility is that, you know, it may be just kind of diffuse bony aches, but not necessarily myeloma bone pain. You know, one common side effect that, you know, of, you know, Zometa, for example, that some of my patients report, especially early on, you know, after, you know, before they have, you know, 4 to 6 months of Zometa under their belt, is kind of a flu-like, you know, achy joints, you know, myalgia type of side effect that can sometimes last for a few days to a week after getting Zometa. So it might be perhaps, you know, some of the supportive medicines that are going on. And then obviously neuropathy. Neuropathy has, you know, more than one manifestation. Most commonly, you know, it can, you know, it presents with, you know, paresthesias, tingling, numbness, burning sensations. But, you know, muscle cramping is actually one potential manifestation of neuropathy, you know, and so, you know, extremity pain, you know, may not always actually be bone pain. And then I think the last important thing to mention in terms of bone pain that I don't think, you know, everybody is aware of, and this doesn't apply to a lot of people, but some people need growth factor support. So, you know, Neupogen or Neulasta, if you run into problems with neutropenia, which is not that of an uncommon side effect of Revlimid and Pomalyst and those types of medications, you know, bone pain is a very common side effect of Neupogen. And so I think that's something that you know, if you do happen to need to start Neupogen and start noticing increased aches, that's a very important thing to tell your doctor, because the solution could often be quite simple as some antihistamines, believe it or not. So even something like a Claritin or a Zyrtec or a Benadryl at night, we still don't totally understand the mechanism behind it, but can be very effective for knocking out Neupogen or Neulasta-associated bone pain. You know, can sometimes even be more effective than, you know, Percocet or other opioids. So I could probably give you another half hour answer to that, but bottom line is I think there's a number of causes of bone or bone-like pain, and I think it's important just to address all the different possibilities to see where what's going on and to make sure we maximize the supportive comfort care. Yeah. Sir?
There's been mention of peripheral neuropathy. Apparently it's very popularly seen in the feet. And along with that, I've noticed proprioception. I'm not always sure of where my feet are. This seems to have taken away my favorite kinds of activities to get moving, which involve tennis, skiing, ice hockey, and the like, and using a bicycle, for example, when you don't know where your feet are, those kinds of activities are very difficult or challenging, presenting even dangers at times. Mm-hmm. I'm wondering if you have been thinking through the way to get exercise to fight the fatigue factors and the like, which don't involve these dangers that are associated with peripheral neuropathy in the feet.
Right. So I'm sorry. The question, sir, is...
The question is, what can you do that doesn't involve hurting your feet even more than they currently hurt?
Right. Well, your point about proprioception is a great one, and we often focus on just the sensory aspect. You know, are you tingling? Are you numb? But, you know, the same, you know, nerves control sensation are the ones that are important for proprioception, knowing where your legs and your feet are in space, which goes along with coordination.
Near killed myself playing tennis.
Yeah. And, you know, I number one, kudos to you for you know, getting out on the tennis court, and I think that's great. But obviously, you know, even further along down those lines, you know, problems with proprioception and balance are big risk factors for falls, you know, and pathologic fractures. So your point about proprioception should not be, you know, is a great one and should not be undervalued. What I can say is, you know, unfortunately, you know, there's no medicine that can, you know, actually improve proprioception, you know, once that the neuropathy has done its damage to those nerves. Obviously, you know, gabapentin, Lyrica, these types of medicines can be very helpful in terms of controlling, you know, painful
neuropathy.
Yes,
but they only make you feel better about not knowing where your feet are.
Exactly. Yeah, and I wish we had a medicine that restored proprioception, but the truth is, sir, that, you know, we don't. And I think that's an important thing to let your oncologist know, because even in the absence of sensory paresthesias or actual motor weakness, you know, problems with proprioception that are really impacting your quality of life, I think, are important in terms of determining the dose and the frequency of the Velcade that you're getting. And the only other thing I will say is there's a couple of standard practices here at Dana-Farber that we tend to believe in terms of at least having some likelihood of reducing severity of neuropathy over the long term. Number one is ensuring adequate hydration. I mean, you probably remember back in the day we used to give Velcade intravenously, and it was very potent, but we were unfortunately not rarely putting some people into wheelchairs because of the severe neuropathy that would happen. And then we found that giving subcutaneous Velcade really cut down on the incidence of severe neuropathy. But in the initial studies that we did with sub-Q Velcade, because it was sub-Q and we weren't necessarily starting IVs, we actually cut the hydration. And you know, this is before my time, but Paul and colleagues noticed that there were still some people who were getting pretty significant, you know, higher grade neuropathy, at which point we reinstituted IV hydration with sub-Q Velcade, and then those high grade neuropathy cases almost vanished. So I think, you know, that's something that hasn't been widely adopted in the community, in my opinion. There's a lot of oncologists who do that, but some who still don't. So I personally am a believer in hydration, and if you don't get it through the IV on your Velcade days especially, you want to be certain that you're getting good oral hydration, because I think those are the days that are most important for, you know, flushing the toxins out, so to speak, and reducing the oxidative free radical damage to the neuron. And the second thing is split dosing of the steroid. So our standard practice here is not just 40 milligrams or however many milligrams once a day on your Velcade day, but actually, you know, splitting that dose and giving you day of and day after, because the steroid, in addition to being the WD-40 of your regimen in terms of anti-myeloma effect, it's also a very potent anti-inflammatory drug. And we think there's a very real benefit of reducing inflammation around the nerve in those 48 hours after the Velcade. So I'm not sure if that was mentioned, but those are two supportive measures that I think you can definitely try. And then lastly, physical therapy has been very helpful for a lot of my patients in terms of, improving function, sometimes even they report improved coordination. But anyway, that's my long-winded way of saying, unfortunately, sir, we don't really have a silver bullet to restore proprioception from bortezomib-induced neuropathy or transplant-induced neuropathy other than to cut the dose and reduce the frequency or sometimes altogether stop the proteasome inhibitor.
I was also asking if you had any comments on exercise regimens that did not involve the use of the feet that would work toward improving the fatigue issue.
I think that's the consensus answer. Yeah, absolutely. Low impact, zero gravity, the aspect of swimming is great. Anything really, low impact, I think, is preferable for myeloma patients with either active bone disease or a history of, compression fractures or anything like that. I've had patients who swear by, yoga. I've had patients who, say they have good luck with Pilates, but I think ultimately, sir, it's an individualized answer. I wish I had a better answer in terms of how to improve coordination, other than, reducing dose. Yeah.
You're obviously very academically, I have a quality of life issue for my husband, who would very much like to visit with some relatives that are young. What is there anything beyond the Purell and a paper mask? Are there ear purifiers that you could put in? So this is a quality of life issue. It,
sure.
It really makes him feel bad, but he doesn't want to end up in the hospital because he's on active treatment after, he's on maintenance treatment now.
Right. I think air purifiers sound like a good idea to me, although, they actually haven't been validated. There's no actual data to suggest that the, incidence of infection is cut down. But to me, that makes sense. I don't think it's going to make anything worse. I don't think it's going to hurt anything. So I think it's reasonable to do that. Hand sanitization and avoiding direct/droplet contact with sick loved ones, I think, is the nuts and bolts of how to avoid infection. And I certainly, don't recommend that grandparents stay away from their grandchildren, because obviously that's, I think, an unacceptable, recommendation from a quality of life standpoint. But the short answer is, making sure you are, totally compliant with hand sanitization, as well as, mask precautions in the setting of sick contacts, or potentially in the setting of, unavoidable crowded situations like crowded, restaurants and bars and things like that.
Airplanes,
absolutely, yeah. Yeah.
I mean, that's a crowd and you're enclosed. There's not even fresh air.
Right. So, yeah, I recommend to my patients who are, to be fair, there are, some people who do fantastic, they're on their, sixth year of Revlimid maintenance and they have zero problems with infections, and I don't necessarily recommend that they wear masks everywhere they go. But obviously for patients who, are battling with, more than minimal neutropenia, low immunoglobulin levels, a history of either recurrent or severe sinus or pulmonary infections, I tend to recommend erring on the side of caution, wearing masks in those kinds of situations. But importantly, not necessarily just, staying at home and locking yourself in your room, but living your life, traveling as you want to travel, but doing so with those precautions. Yeah.
Also, turmeric.
Right. Yeah.
I'm not suggesting, this is a new question.
Right.
Turmeric, what is your in addition, I'm not saying instead of, but to augment the effect of Levlimid or instead of it,
turmeric, I love it. I eat a lot of it just in terms of the food. But in terms of as a supplement, again, I don't think we have great data on it at this point. You know, those studies are being done. But to date, you know, we don't have actual scientific data that, you know, a diet high in curcumin, you know, will actually, you know, augment the immune system and you know, augment the effect of Revlimid, you know, in a meaningful way that actually translates into outcomes. But those studies are being done. You know, this is still a relatively, you know, kind of new area of research focus. And I think we're going to have that data at some point, but we just don't have it yet. Along those lines, you know, there are, you know, other things, mostly in terms, these things are, lifestyle interventions are mainly being looked at in kind of the smoldering setting and the MGUS setting in terms of actual potential preventive strategies. You know, like there are some, you know, vitamin D studies that are being done to see if we can actually, you know, alter the natural course of these, you know, blood malignancies. But in terms of do we have data to actually, you know, on which to base recommendations for specific supplements to improve the actual efficacy and chances of remission with RVD, KRD, DARA, we just don't. Yeah.
Well, I suppose the question to ask would be, can they hurt to add them? Can you be decreasing the efficacy of Revlimid or DARA or whatever?
Well, again, until those studies are actually done in a controlled manner, the honest answer is I don't know. But mechanistically, I think there's a low likelihood that it's actually going that turmeric specifically is actually going to have an antagonistic effect on the treatment. In terms of, you know, data that we do have for potential antagonistic effect, the only kind of commonly ingested substance that I think we do have some not conclusive data, just totally retrospective data in the setting of immune therapy is actually marijuana or cannabis. There was this, you know, a study out of, and again, this is, I'm not recommending for or against, but just, you know, since you asked, there was a study out of Israel about a year ago looking at not myeloma, but, you know, other types of cancer, mainly non-small cell lung cancer patients, and looking to see if there was any association between likelihood of response to immunotherapy, like the PD-1, you know, PD-L1 based therapy, and ingestion of cannabis. And actually, those investigators found that in those who ingested cannabis, the response rate to immunotherapy was cut by about 50%. There is some evidence that there's an immunosuppressive effect of that, right, which is potentially why medicinal marijuana is very, very helpful to some people and some other medical conditions. But in terms of, you know, that just being one example of something where I think there, if there is data that there's actually an immunosuppressive effect, you know, then I would say until we have better data to err on the side of maybe, you know, not throwing those kinds of things into the mix, you know, unless we can, you know, as long as we can help it. Yep.
Hi. I was wondering if you could explain the difference between a bony lesion, a soft tissue lesion,
sure,
and a tumor.
Great question. So a bony lesion in myeloma, you know, usually refers to, you know, what we call an osteolytic lesion. So, you know, an actual area of focal destruction, you know, of the bone cortex, and, you know, the vast majority of, you know, myeloma, we see those. In terms of a bony tumor or a, you know, plasmacytoma, essentially, you know, there's a kind of a spectrum of bone manifestations, and, you know, it's not, you know, black and white, one or the other. There are plasmacytomas that can kind of essentially grow out of osteolytic lesions, but simply as I can put it, a plasmacytoma is a myeloma tumor, an actual mass, you know, not an area of destruction of the bone where essentially there's, you know, a lesion or a hole in the bone, but an actual tumor that you can measure millimeter by millimeter. And so that when we talk about plasmacytomas versus lytic lesions, that's what we mean. Myeloma tumor versus a destructive lesion of the bone. Most plasmacytomas are associated with the bone. So for example, there's this, you know, there's this, you know, there's a diagnosis known as, you know, SPB or solitary plasmacytoma of the bone, where a patient will present literally with one, you know, tumor, a mass-like lesion that seems to be growing out of the bone, you know, with no evidence of myeloma in the marrow or no other lesion. And those patients, even though about 60% of patients with solitary plasmacytoma of the bone will eventually develop, you know, systemic myeloma, there are a minority who, if you just radiate that single myeloma tumor, you know, they actually don't recur. So that's kind of on one end of the spectrum, and on the other end, you have patients who present with multiple plasmacytomas. So multiple plasmacytomas equals multiple myeloma, and we treat it in the same way as a systemic process. And a minority of patients at diagnosis will present with multiple plasmacytomas, but the incidence of plasmacytomas increases the further down the line we get with each additional relapse. The other entity to differentiate between plasmacytoma of the bone or what we call soft tissue plasmacytomas. So again, these are myeloma tumors that seem to not have any relation to the bone. They're not growing out of the bone. They just kind of pop up potentially in different organs, you know, or, you know, miles away from the nearest, you know, major bone. And again, you know, these are plasmacytomas we can see at any point throughout the course of myeloma, but we tend to see more of them in the more heavily pretreated patients who are, you know, more years out from their initial diagnosis. Again, historically, you know, plasmacytoma of the soft tissue seems to be a bit more of a, you know, a kind of a have a negative prognosis associated with it as opposed to plasmacytoma of the bone. But again, these are all historical numbers. And they don't factor in, you know, all of these great new treatments that we've had over the past 4 years, you know, much less, you know, the ones that we're going to probably have in the next year or two. So so I hope that answered your question.
What about the soft tissue lesion?
Soft tissue lesion in myeloma would essentially be a synonym for a soft tissue plasmacytoma. I would say they're one and the same. Sir.
So I'll try to make this quick. So I'm on a management therapy with Revlimid. Someday it may or should relapse. And there are several replacement chemotherapies that were mentioned today. There were also immunotherapies.
Right.
What's your opinion between chemotherapies and immunotherapies for continuing maintenance?
So that's a great question. And the bottom line answer is I don't know, meaning that we have multiple options from which to choose. And I don't think it's a, and I think this is a great thing, in that it's no longer a, you know, one size fits all type of scenario. For example, you know, we have patients who, and I don't know the details of obviously your course, sir, but you know, patients who say will, you know, go into initial remission with RVD, you know, with or without transplant, and then go on maintenance Revlimid, do quite well for, you know, for many years, for, you know, for, you know, 5+ years, and then we'll have a very slow, what we call biochemical progression, right? Meaning that we see, you know, the M spike go from nothing to 0.1 to 0.2, you know, over the course of literally like 6 months to a year with nothing else going on, right? No new anemia, no new bone lesions. And so for that patient who has, you know, a myeloma that's starting to outsmart the Revlimid, you know, but still, you know, has, you know, a relatively, you know, kind of indolent clone, we would say, that's not, you know, coming back like gangbusters, potentially, you know, a very well tolerated doublet or triplet based regimens, for example, you know, pomalidomide dexamethasone alone, has about a, you know, overall 30% response rate in patients specifically whose myeloma has just come back through Revlimid, so Revlimid refractory myeloma. And so there, you know, there are some patients who say, you know, maybe, you know, have very slowly progressive disease, who may be, you know, on the right side of, say, you know, 70 years old and may have, you know, other medical issues and that they're dealing with. And so for those patients, I think something as simple as, you know, Pomalyst dexamethasone alone may be enough. But obviously for somebody who is maybe a bit younger, you know, has less other, you know, issues and side effects to worry about, and whose myeloma is coming back, you know, either, you know, more rapidly or obviously associated with a clinical relapse with new, you know, kidney dysfunction or new bony lesions, then I think most myeloma specialists in 2019 would opt for a triplet regimen, so three drugs, you know, to include dexamethasone. And so, for example, one of the clinical trials that we have open right now is the, you know, the multi-center alliance study throughout the U.S., which is randomizing patients with slow biochemical progressions, what I just talked about, to Pom-Dex alone versus Pom-Dex plus ixazomib, or you know, quote-unquote oral Velcade. And so we're trying to answer those questions in terms of who needs a triplet regimen, is a triplet regimen, you know, actually going to result in a clinical, you know, meaningful benefit over a doublet regimen by itself? And those are questions that we still haven't yet ironed out. But in the absence of that alliance data, what I would say, sir, is that for most patients, I tend to offer triplet-based, novel agent-based regimens, that would include, you know, a proteasome inhibitor plus an IMID, so say, you know, pomalidomide plus ixazomib or pomalidomide plus carfilzomib or something like that, or a daratumumab-based regimen. And we have increasingly really promising data from the daratumumab studies in the relapse setting. You know, just last week we had 4-year updated results from both the Pollux and the Castor studies, which was Dara Revlimid Dex and then Dara Velcade Dex, you know, in the relapse setting. And, you know, those curves are continuing to separate in terms of patients treated with Dara, you know, having, you know, significantly longer durations of remission, you know, higher rates of, you know, negativity for minimal residual disease, so the very deep remissions, you know, compared to, say, you know, an IMID or a PI, you know, by itself. And interestingly, we, for the very first time, as of last week, we have what's called PFS2 data from those DARA-containing regimens, basically showing that, you know, on average, you know, people who are treated with DARA in the relapse setting, you know, after they progress through DARA, their next remission doesn't seem to be much shorter compared to patients who don't get DARA, and those are data that we haven't seen at all until last week. So I personally think that the antibodies like daratumumab, elotuzumab, are going to be increasingly recommended for patients, you know, early on in relapse disease, you know, potentially, you know, at the time of first relapse, you know, as opposed to, you know, the third or the fourth or the fifth line, which is how they've been studied up to this point. So I do think DARA and ISA and these, you know, CD38 monoclonal antibodies are going to be seen moving, you know, more leftward, you know, closer and closer, you know, to, you know, first relapse, you know, in patients who obviously haven't already gotten them as part of a quad induction regimen for newly diagnosed myeloma. So that's my long-winded way of saying you have multiple options. On the one hand, you don't want to undertreat the myeloma, you know, but on the other hand, you know, we have a very real, you know, danger of hurting patients unnecessarily, whose myeloma might not need 3 or 4 of the most potent drugs at the time of first relapse. And we're just trying to get better and better at identifying who needs, you know, the pedal to the metal approach, you know, and who can be, you know, very, you know, adequately treated with, you know, a much less toxic approach. And the last thing I'll say along those lines is in terms of, you mentioned chemo versus immunotherapy. So again, I've been talking about novel agents, but your question was chemo versus immunotherapy. When I, you know, when I hear the word chemo, I think transplant, right? Because that's what transplant is, you know, high-dose melphalan, you know, what I call the old time or the old school stuff that's been around since the 80s and the 90s. The question of whether to transplant somebody who's been doing well on maintenance Revlimid, who has not gotten a transplant already, is another great question that, again, the answer, I think, is very individualized. You know, in general, you know, right now, the question we're trying to answer for patients who are transplant eligible, you know, transplant candidates, is, you know, the role of upfront versus delayed transplant, meaning do you get your high-dose melphalan in your first remission after you've got however many cycles of RVD or KRD, or do you just get your stem cells collected, you know, and then continue your novel agent-based regimen, you know, till the cows come home, and then at the time of your first disease progression or relapse, get the transplant at that time. So that's the question that we've been trying to answer, and Paul's been leading the charge on that from the American arm of what we call the determination study. The answer right now that we have is that there's no evidence to suggest that overall doing a transplant upfront results in an overall survival advantage. You know, it definitely will increase the length of the first remission, the progression-free interval, but in the RVD era, we just don't have data to say that it's going to help people live longer compared to if they keep transplant in reserve. But the follow-up question to that, that nobody has an answer for, sir, is, well, okay, at the time of that first progression or relapse, you know, do I have to get a transplant even then? And what I would say is that for most people who are still transplant eligible, again, you know, relatively young, at low risk for, you know, severe complications of the transplant, you know, I think most people would say if you don't get the transplant up front, then you want to at least think really hard about going for it, you know, at the time of, you know, first disease progression. So getting that progressive myeloma back into a second remission and then doing a transplant at that time. But again, in the era of CAR T, bispecific antibodies, you know, other immunotherapies that are coming down the pipeline, you know, the question of, you know, can I do just as well, if not better, going for those treatments at the time of my first relapse versus, you know, the old time, you know, high dose chemo and transplant, you know, that's a question that nobody has an answer for right now, sir. Yeah.
Are there any in vitro assays for personalized medicine? In other words, if you take a bone marrow sample and submit it, and it can be in vitro tested, this particular bone marrow matches up well with this particular agent. Is there anywhere here or anywhere in the world that does that personalized?
There's multiple groups that are working on that. There's nothing that's ready for prime time. There's nothing that's commercially available. And I guess I should choose my words carefully, because there's a couple different things we could be talking about here. One is, I think what you're talking about is like an in vitro assay that directly tests the sensitivity of those cells
exactly.
that are collected, exposes them to the drug.
Exactly.
Right. And then allows the, you know, oncologist to select the drugs that those cells are most specific to.
Right.
You know, there are people who are looking at that within the realm of myeloma. There's nothing that is, to my knowledge, that is anywhere near prime time in terms of being validated as actually being the way to go over just the way that we currently practice. But I think that those kinds of assays are on their way. I think there's nothing but promise in terms of how helpful they could be to us. But we're just we're nowhere near basing our newly diagnosed decisions on such assays. What we are, I think, not that far away from, though, is being able to tailor initial therapy based not only on you know, classifying somebody as being, say, you know, cytogenetically standard risk or high risk or, you know, these kind of vague prognostic category terms, but actually choosing specific drugs based on, you know, specific, gene mutations that we identify. You know, I think a perfect example of that would be, you know, the drug venetoclax or Venclexta, yeah, that obviously got a lot of bad press in 2019 because of the Bellini trial, which I'm not sure if that was mentioned yet today or not. But, you know, this, so venetoclax is, you know, in the realm of non-myeloma hematologic malignancy has really been the best thing since sliced bread over the past, you know, 5 or 10 years. You know, it's what's called a BCL2 inhibitor, and it's, you know, rapidly emerging as becoming standard of care in things like CLL or, you know, non-Hodgkin lymphoma.
But it only works for 414, right? Isn't it?
1114. And that's exactly what I'm getting at, is when we, you know, initially studied it in myeloma, you know, the results were promising, but in the phase 3 study, the Bellini study, right, we saw significantly improved response rates, you know, and progression-free survival, but a doubling, actually, of the treatment-related mortality. So more patients were responding, but unfortunately, more patients were dying, and as soon as the FDA saw that, they, you know, put the kibosh on all venetoclax myeloma trials. Importantly, in the, you know, the biomarker analysis that followed, we saw that those unfortunate events were exclusively being seen in the non-1114 translocated patient population, right? And when you actually looked at the 1114 positive patients, the hazard ratio, you know, for progression or death was 0.1, which, again, you know, I'm sorry to talk in academic terms, but that means that it was a really significant benefit. We rarely see, you know, numbers that strong in myeloma trials, but for 1114 positive patients, we saw that, and we saw none of the negative, you know, sequela in terms of, you know, risk of increased infection or progression. So, you know, as of just very recently, the FDA has lifted its clinical hold on studies of this drug, but are specifically, they're only allowing us to continue these trials in the 1114 positive patients. So I think that's a perfect example of, although it's not yet ready for prime time in terms of giving venetoclax to someone, you know, right out of the gate at diagnosis, you know, I do think more and more we're going to, you know, hopefully in a much smarter way before we do these trials and you know, wind up shooting ourselves in the foot, so to speak, with these trials that maybe could have been, you know, fleshed out a little bit more preclinically in terms of dividing up the biologic effects of these drugs before we do an all-comers trial, a phase 3 trial. But I think, you know, I think venetoclax has a very, very bright future in myeloma, but only for specific patients based on biology. So I think we're much closer to that than we are to, you know, kind of the in vitro assay-based decisions for new diagnosis. But potentially I could be wrong, and, you know, in another ASH or two, we may see, you know, some data on that. Okay, long day, all right.
One more quick question. Just a quick question. So based on a transplant, right, I picked up that somebody's having a transplant after a second or third treatment. Is that when the cells were collected after the first treatment, or can you collect the cells after second or third treatment?
Right, so it's always possible to collect enough cells after the second or third treatment, but the likelihood gets lower and lower. So really the treatment algorithm, you know, the strategic algorithm is if you want to even consider a transplant in a delayed setting, whether it's after the second or the third treatment, you want to collect those cells in first remission. So that's the general, you know, kind of workflow that most of us oncologists follow.
Thanks.
So as everyone's heading for the door, I want to make a few quick thanks to Ashley, Charlotte, Katie, Sam, Jack, Amy, and Katie, and all the members of the organizing committee that put this together. Couldn't have done it without you. And then very lastly, especially for everyone who stayed until the very end, You know, just really want to thank you for coming out and being here. You know, you're more than just our patients. You're our partners and our inspiration for getting up in the morning and doing what we do. So great to see everybody, and hope you're back next year. And thanks so much.